Good afternoon. We now have portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture and Parliamentary Business. And at question number one, I call Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Channel 4 in relation to increasing its made outside England quota from 9% to 16%, in line with population breakdown, as called for by PACT, the independent TV representative body.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Scottish Government officials have met Channel 4 on several occasions. I met with the Channel 4 Chief Executive on the 23rd of May. In our communications with Channel 4 and the regulator Ofcom, including letters on the 26th of April, the 25th of June and the 28th of August, we challenged the inadequate made outside of England quotas proposed and set out our expectation that they should be increased to at least 16% with individual nation quotas. Scottish Government also responded to both of Ofcom's consultations on the 14th of February and the 28th of August to set out these views.
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary shares my anger that Ofcom chose not to proceed with a 16% quota but instead a 12% quota, and even that is not until 2030. This will mean 25% less programmes and 25% less people than if the quota had been accepted. Scottish freelancers in the independent TV industry are really hurting, with many being forced out of the industry. So what more can the Government do in conjunction with PACT and Screen Scotland to protect this industry as it goes through a difficult time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, may I commend Douglas Lumsden for his question and the way in which he framed it, because I think the difference between 12% and 16% may not seem much to some who don't understand how much that's worth. But in effect, as he points out, this is a 25% underspend, which would have an impact on the television sector in Scotland, which would not be welcomed. He asks, what more can we do? Well, one thing that's really apparent and has become increasingly apparent is that not only is the Scottish Government, the Welsh Government, the Northern Irish Government and our screen agencies making the very same points as he is, we're hearing voices from across parliaments doing exactly the same thing. So I would commend him and colleagues in his party and indeed others who are making this point. The more who make this point between now and final decisions, the better chance we have of getting fairness for Channel 4 spending in Scotland, just as we have worked so hard to secure from the BBC.
Question number two, Alexander Burnett.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it has had any discussions with organisations in the arts and culture sector since the publication of a programme for Government 24-25, and I note my register of interest as a supporter of the arts.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Government officials and ministers are in regular contact with key stakeholders across the arts and culture sector as part of the normal business of government, and this engagement has continued since the publication of the programme for government on the 4th of September.
Alexander Burnett.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Now, in the past 2 years, this SNP government has repeatedly cut Creative Scotland's budget, only to restore it after backlash, sometimes framing these reversals as new investment. The recent restoration of the Open Fund is just the latest example, and after a joint campaign by 150 arts organisations, including Devon Projects and the Barn in my constituency. So does a Cabinet Secretary understand how this misleads the sector and undermines trust in the government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would gently point out Alexander Burnett that claiming that there's been a reduction in culture spending in Scotland would itself be misleading, because spending in culture and the arts in Scotland is up. And I appreciate that everybody who cares about the arts and culture sector wishes to see that raise in spending, the commitments being laid out of a growth and of an annual amount to £100 million, which would be a tremendous boost to the sector. But I think it's really, really important that notwithstanding the pressures, notwithstanding the difficulties, but this government is raising culture spending. And I would contrast that with both the UK government, past and present, which is cutting the spending of the Department of Culture, Media and Sport in England, and indeed the Welsh Labour government, which is cutting funding in Wales. In Scotland, we are increasing funding in culture and trying to do it as quickly as we can.
I have three requests for supplementaries. I intend to take all three. First supplementary, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the dispute between the Paisley Arts Institute and OneRen that has resulted in the looming possibility of highly valuable local artworks being auctioned off next week. A number of constituents, including the artist Ailey Montague, who has started a petition, feel passionately that artworks gifted to Paisley should not be lost to the town, either through sale or moving to Glasgow, as has been suggested. Once they're gone, they're gone. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary whether the Scottish Government will look urgently and closely at this and offer to convene talks between the two parties to try and find a positive resolution?
Well, may I begin by thanking Neil Bibby, not just for this question, but the way in which he's already raised this. Neil Bibby contacted me a number of days ago to highlight this issue, which is a matter of concern to him and constituents who have raised this with him. I gave him the undertaking that I would raise this with senior Scottish Government officials in the Culture Directorate so that we would have a look to better understand the circumstances which he's outlined to Parliament today. This has currently been undertaken. I gave him a commitment that I would revert to him in the course of this week to let him know what view we are able to take on the challenge that he has outlined to Parliament. I intend to get back to him on the details of that, and it would be appropriate to update Parliament in due course about progress with this particular issue. I would be content to do so, but I intend to work with Neil Bibby, as I have given that commitment to him in the spirit that he raised the question with me, and I very much welcome the way in which he's done that.
Supplementary, Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Labour Government's austerity budget June-October is expected to have a substantial impact on the Scottish Government's finances in the year ahead. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide further assurances that despite the cuts coming from Westminster, that the Scottish Government will continue to invest in the arts and culture sector? And can he update the Chamber on his latest engagement with the UK Government regarding future finances and the impact they could have on the Scottish Government's spending plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
So it is a matter of fact that I've already updated the Chamber on this afternoon that the Scottish Government has increased culture sector funding this financial year by over £15 million as the first step to achieving the First Minister's commitment to invest at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by 2028-29. This commitment to additional funding comes despite the challenging budget situation and signals our continued confidence in the culture sector and the value that we place on it as government in Scotland. The Scottish budget continues to face significant challenges, and no additional funding has been confirmed as part of the Chancellor's recent statement. As is normal practice, any consequentials will be confirmed as part of the supplementary estimates process in early 2025. And of course, the Scottish Government will continue to work with the new UK Government to seek clarity on any changes which may have an impact on funding in Scotland.
And supplementary, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The screen machine, which is parked outside just now in Holyrood Park, brings cinema to communities that would have no other access, but sadly its future is under threat. Screen Scotland have provided funding to extend the lease of the current machine for 2 years, and this is welcome, but it's going to take 12 to 18 months to build a new state-of-the-art machine. Therefore, the clock is ticking. A fundraising campaign has been launched to raise £100,000 from the public as part of the total of £1.7 million required for the new machine. The campaign has support from Judy Dench, Alan Cumming, Tidelines, because without urgent intervention, our rural communities will lose their access to cinema. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps the Scottish Government are taking to make sure this doesn't happen?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, may I begin by thanking Rhoda Grant for her question and putting on record that the project that matters so much, particularly to our rural and island communities in terms of the screen machine, is being funded by Screen Scotland, which is funded by the Scottish Government. So we are supportive of the retention of that vital lifeline cultural service to rural and island Scotland. I commend her for raising the fact that there is a fundraising drive currently underway, and I would encourage each and all members who are able to support that and publicise that, please, to do so. I, as did she, visited the screen machine outside the Scottish Parliament yesterday. I commend colleagues who have not yet done so. Please go and see it. It is absolutely tremendous. I'm very seized of making sure that this service remains in operation, that there is a replacement mobile cinema, and with the help and support of colleagues right across the Chamber, I'm encouraged that we can work towards that, which is a shared objective.
Question number three, Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to invest in supporting youth culture in the Cunningham South constituency.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Government places great importance on cultural activity in the local community, and we believe that young people of all backgrounds should have the opportunity to access quality cultural services in their local area. The Scottish Government support a range of organisations through Creative Scotland. In the Cunningham South constituencies, these include the Irvine and Dreghorn Brass Band and Music Education Partnership, We Make Music Libraries Group, which caters to young people specifically. And we also provide upwards of £190,000 in support of North Ayrshire Council's highly regarded Youth Music Initiative programme based in Cunningham, whose work reaches all schools in the local authority area.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I welcome that the Scottish Government is increasing funding in culture. Arts and culture are an integral part of a thriving community. This summer I had the pleasure of visiting Impact Arts, where I saw firsthand the vital work that they are doing to provide artistic opportunities for young people, the positive impact it had on their well-being and the prospects it opened up to them. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that money invested by the Scottish Government through Creative Scotland should be distributed across the country for the benefit of all, ensuring that the arts are developed for young people outside of our main cities?
Cabinet Secretary.
We know that it's vital to nurture culture and creativity across all of Scotland's communities, and the funding that we provide via Creative Scotland reaches individuals, reaches organisations, reaches projects right across the whole of Scotland. For example, our long-standing investment of over £150 million since 2007 in the Youth Music Initiative continues to support and empower young people in all of Scotland's 32 local authorities, allowing them to access music-making and learning opportunities, with every pupil being offered a year's free music tuition by the end of primary school.
A supplementary, Katie Clark.
There's no doubt that there has been significant cuts to youth services in recent years. To what extent does the Cabinet Secretary believe it is the impact of council cuts in North Ayrshire and elsewhere which have led to the reductions in services, including arts and culture, targeted at young people?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've just outlined a series of ways in which cultural provision is being both delivered and protected in local authorities, including the region that she represents. If she has any particular examples of cultural services that have been cut that I may not be aware of, I would be perfectly happy to take a look at that. I'm absolutely committed to ensuring that Scotland's culture and arts agencies that deliver in different ways do so right across Scotland, and that young people, no matter where they are and no matter what their background, are given the option of being able to participate and take part in cultural activities. And I look forward to her perhaps reaching out to me with any information that she may have.
Question number four, Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the UK Government about improving relations with the European Union, including on rejoining the Single Market and Customs Union.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government's long-standing position is that rejoining the Single Market and the Customs Union at the earliest opportunity as an independent country represents the best future for Scotland. Brexit has been and continues to be a disaster for Scotland. I've conveyed to the current UK Government that I welcome its intention to reset the relationship with the EU and made clear that we must do all that we can to reduce the harm of Brexit wherever possible. However, the Scottish Government will continue to advocate rejoining the European Union and the huge benefits that that would bring, including access to the world's largest single market and customs union, a customs union that is seven times larger than the United Kingdom.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A decade ago today, people went to the polls to vote in the independence referendum, and they had been told that to protect our membership of the European Union, that they had to vote no. That was not the case, and we find that out to our cost not long after. Isn't it fair to say that if the UK had not made the disastrous decision to leave the EU at an estimated cost of £40 billion per annum to the economy, then the proposed £22 billion of cuts from this Labour government may have been avoided entirely?
Cabinet Secretary.
Kevin Stewart makes very good points. It is a statement of fact that the Scottish electorate was missold. in 2014. They were told they should vote no to protect Scotland's place in the European Union. Since then, we were taken out against the democratic will of the majority of people in this country. Independent research organisations and the Office for Budget Responsibility have been tracking the economic impact of Brexit since the referendum in 2016, when, of course, Scotland voted overwhelmingly to remain in the European Union. And according to analysis by the National Institute of Social and Economic Research, the UK economy is 2.5% smaller in 2023, and it expects it to rise by 5.7% by 2035. This equates to around £69 billion in output and £28 billion in public revenues lost as a consequence of Brexit. This immense economic hole is a stark reminder of the price of Labour's continued support for Brexit.
Question number five, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what work it is doing to enhance protection of the nation's built heritage and listed buildings.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I start off by acknowledging Paul Sweeney's long-standing interest in this area. The Scottish Government delivers support for the historic environment through sponsorship of Historic Environment Scotland, the lead public body for the protection and preservation of the historic environment. And as reported in their 23-24 grants funding report, Historic Environment Scotland delivers over £13 million of grant funding each year for the protection and promotion of the historic environment in projects across Scotland.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The listed ABC venue on Sockhill Street was badly damaged in the second Glasgow School of Art fire in 2018 and has lain derelict ever since. A planning application was recently submitted to build student accommodation on the site, but within weeks Glasgow City Council had then served a dangerous buildings notice on the property, slating it for full demolition. At no point was a conservation accredited engineer consulted to see whether the iconic entrance portico at least could be preserved and incorporated into the design of the new development. The similar situations have prevailed at Air Station Hotel and most recently at the Hillhead Baptist Church in the west end of Glasgow. For the listing process to have the weight it should have, at the very least, Deputy Presiding Officer, it should be a necessity to consult a registered conservation engineer before any green light is given to demolition. So will the Scottish Government consider Save Britain's Heritage's call to make it mandatory to seek the advice of a care accredited structural engineer before any planning authority authorises demolition
Well, Paul Sweeney has raised a number of issues in a number of sites there, which include matters which pertain to planning, and he'll be aware that Scottish Government ministers need to be very careful in relation to those sort of issues because of our quasi-judicial role with those. He has raised the issue of the ABC. It is on the public record. No doubt that is being looked at closely. He also raises the issue of Hillhead Baptist Church. I'm very well aware of the detailed objection letter that he has publicised on his own website, and I know that there's still some time to run until those objections can be handed in by constituents who may share his views. In terms of the issue that he's raised beyond that, in terms of listing and so on, I will revert to officials and I will write him a substantive issue on that because I think we all agree that we want to make sure that our historic built environment is protected as much as possible.
Supplementary, Beatrice Bishop.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The nature of the materials used in historic and listed buildings requires traditional skills so that restoration and maintenance is done sympathetically. What can the Scottish Government do in terms of flexible learning opportunities for young people in island and rural areas so they can access and acquire those specialist skills and ensure we have a pipeline of skilled craftspeople across Scotland to help retain and protect heritage buildings?
Cabinet Secretary.
The point that Beatrice Wishart raises is very apposite. Often I've heard from colleagues specific issues focused on stonemasonry, but there are other traditional skills that are absolutely essential for us to maintain our historic and built environment. There are a lot of efforts going on behind the scenes to make sure that we are able to ensure that our places of learning at a variety of different levels are able to allow young people to accrue the skills that are necessary for all of those undertakings. I will write to Beatrice Wishart to update her on that, and if she has any specific issues relating to her constituency or indeed others in the wider region, I'd be very keen to hear from her on that.
Question number six, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to support the retention of Scotland's public libraries.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Government officials work closely with the Scottish Library and Information Council, which provides leadership and advice to Scottish ministers, to local authorities and the wider library sector. In 2022-23, 23-24 and 24-25, we've provided funding of £665,000 to the SLIC as recognition of the importance of our public libraries and as an expression of our support for the excellent services that they provide. This is on top of the Scottish Government's general revenue funding to local authorities and includes the Public Library Improvement Fund that supports creative, sustainable and innovative public library projects throughout the whole of Scotland.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply? But since this government came to power, spending on our public libraries is down. Book stocks are down. Library staff are down. And over 120 public libraries have closed for good. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that libraries matter? That they are a vital part of our children's education? That they combat social isolation? That they can help regenerate our towns and cities? That they represent a world beyond the market? A safe space not run for profit but for enlightenment? And that in a digital society, libraries are not needed less, they are needed even more? And if he does accept that, what does the government intend to do about it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I agree entirely with everything that we just heard in terms of the importance of libraries, both for individuals and for communities. And that's why, he did hear my initial answer, the Scottish Government has committed the resources that it has to protect and support the provision of library services across Scotland. There is also an onus on local government to maintain the provision. He knows that as well as I do. And we need to work in partnership to make sure that we maintain libraries as a service the length and breadth of Scotland. If there are any particular issues that he would wish to highlight with him, I would ask him to get in touch with me. Perhaps at the next vote on the Scottish Government's budget, he may wish to exercise his vote to support the resources that are being put into libraries.
I have requests from three members. I would hope to take all three, but I need cooperation to have brief questions and brief answers. Supplementary, Claire Hawkey.
Local authorities, of course, have a statutory duty to provide adequate public library services, and the Labour administration at South Lanarkshire Council is overseeing the closure of three libraries in my constituency in Cambus Lang, Halfway and Blantyre, 75% of the main libraries in my constituency. And this is despite deep concerns from residents about the impact the closures will have. Does the Minister agree with me that it is crucial that local authorities maintain a strategic overview of library services, even if they are commissioned via arm's length bodies, and that meaningful consultation with communities must precede any service changes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it's very disappointing given the rhetoric we heard a moment ago that Labour local authorities like our own are cutting and closing libraries. Public libraries in Scotland are devolved to local authorities, and they have a statutory duty to ensure there is adequate provision of library services for their residents. However, the Scottish Government recognises the significant financial pressures and community-level impacts that flow from 14 years of Westminster austerity. The Labour Government has confirmed that it is to continue that austerity with £22 billion of public spending cuts, with all roads leading back to Westminster, so we hear. As the Labour Government acknowledge, the First Minister has been clear that we need an injection of investment in our public services, not more cuts.
Supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP Government cuts have led to a 14% reduction in Scotland's public libraries, with the Public Library Improvement Fund addressing only a fraction of the funding problems they face. What specific action will the Cabinet Secretary take to address the ongoing impact of these cuts beyond the scope of the current Public Libraries Improvement Fund?
Cabinet Secretary.
I tell you what, Presiding Officer, I'm certainly not going to take any lessons on supporting public services from the party of austerity.
Cabinet Secretary, please resume.
Really does take a brass neck, and no matter how much one shouts on this issue, it doesn't get beyond the fact that it is the UK Conservative Party that implemented austerity. The impact on public spending has been felt the length and breadth of the UK, including Scotland, and I would encourage him to recant on the austerity that his party has been responsible for, and at least acknowledge that that may have some impact on the level of funding, public funding in the UK, not least in England, where under his party's responsibility, cuts to the Department of Culture, Media and Sport have been vast.
Brief supplementary, George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is it not the reality that since the Conservatives came to power in 2010, the austerity agenda has seen UK libraries fall dramatically? What assessment has been made of the impact of Tory-led budget cuts on public libraries in Scotland, as well as the future impact and consequences of the continued austerity measures being supported by the Labour Party?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think if people didn't already understand, I think it is becoming ever more clear that the austerity politics, that is the reduction and constraints on public funding in the United Kingdom, have an impact. I don't understand why Conservative members are shaking their heads. This is a matter of financial fact. The impact of UK government austerity is having a significant impact on public spending in Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland. These are facts. It would be good if at least they and others would recognise that this has an impact on public services, including libraries, and I will not cease, and my colleagues will also not cease, in pointing this out to the Chamber, to the public, given that that's why people voted to get rid of the Conservatives and sadly believed that change was coming with Labour, when sadly it has not.
And I can squeeze in question 7, but I do need cooperation to brief questions and answers. Thank you.
To ask the Scottish Government regarding any impact on the development of its constitutional policy and strategy, what its position is on whether the promises made by the leaders of the three main UK unionist parties prior to the 2014 independence referendum, known as the vow, have been kept.
Cabinet Secretary.
Following the Smith Commission, this Parliament received some additional powers, however far less than what was promised 10 years ago in the lead-up to the independence referendum. We have used those powers to improve the lives of the people of Scotland. However, the last UK government demonstrated that Westminster can block those powers at the drop of a hat. We know that because of the Internal Market Act. We know that because of the breaches to Sewell. We know that because of the interventions and devolved policies and spending. They are evidence of this. There is now an opportunity for the current UK government to address the damage inflicted by its predecessor. We stand ready to work with them to reset the relationship and protect and enhance the powers of this Parliament.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. A decade on, just in budget terms, the Scottish Parliament has no control whatsoever over VAT, national insurance, corporation tax, inheritance tax, fuel, tobacco and alcohol duty, etc. Yet this Parliament has been preposterously described as the most powerful devolved Parliament in the world by Rishi Sunak, Alistair Jack and the new Secretary of State for Scotland, Ian Murray. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that this Parliament's powers pale in comparison to US states, German Länder, Swiss cantons, the Canadian provinces, Australian states, all of which have constitutionally embedded rights and sweeping powers over taxation and spending, not to mention British Crown dependencies like the Isle of Man, Jersey and Guernsey?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Kenneth Gibson is absolutely right. Perhaps it will end the nonsensical claims by some members of this Parliament to the contrary. With the limited powers handed to the Scottish Parliament under the Smith Commission, the Scottish Government has made a real difference in areas where Westminster did not. Policies administered by Social Security Scotland, like the Scottish Child Payment, are helping to keep an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty in Scotland. There's a growing demand for the further devolution of powers in Scotland in areas such as employment rights, immigration, drugs law, all based on the understanding that the Scottish Government can legislate with only the best interests of the people of Scotland at heart. The same cannot be said for Westminster.
And question number 8 has not been lodged. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture and Parliamentary Business. There'll be a very short pause before we move to the next portfolio to allow frontbench teams to change position. Thank you.
Thank you. We will now move on to the next portfolio, which is Justice and Home Affairs. And at question number one, I call Tess White.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of police service strength in light of the decrease in Police Scotland's officer numbers.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constant.
Presiding Officer, while it is important to recognise that the recruitment of police officers is a matter for the Chief Constable, nonetheless, despite the deeply challenging financial circumstances, our budget settlement for 24-25 for Police Scotland includes an additional £75.7 million to protect frontline policing. As the Chief Constable has confirmed to the Criminal Justice Committee, this budget settlement will enable Police Scotland to bring officer numbers up to around 16,500 to 16,600. It should be noted that Police Scotland has welcomed more than 690 new officers since March and over 1,280 new recruits since the beginning of 2023, with further intakes planned throughout this year, and Police Scotland are set to take on more recruits this year than at any time since 2013.
Tess White.
Cabinet Secretary, the number of female probationers in Police Scotland has nosedived by almost a third since 2021. A damning report, and it's an independent report into the force's so-called equality, diversity and inclusion activities, was quietly published by Police Scotland last month. It found, and I quote, pervasive attitudes of misogyny and sexism across all areas and divisions. It describes a hostile environment for women who may choose to leave their careers early. The SNP government cannot look the other way, and alarm bells are ringing. How will the Scottish Government hold Police Scotland to account to ensure it creates a safe space for female employees?
Signing officer, firstly, it should be acknowledged that this Parliament decided on the basis of separation of powers, and therefore this Parliament decided that it's for the Scottish Police Authority to hold Police Scotland and the Chief Constable directly to account. In terms of the substantive issue that Ms White raises about the decrease in number of female probationers, I too share that concern, and actually was pleased when Police Scotland have now opened up their site in Jackton as another recruitment centre in addition to Tully Allen. And that is about Tully Allen, the member may be aware, is a residential training facility for probationers, and actually the purpose of Jackton is to allow people to train to be police officers on a non-residential basis, and I would hope that that would help to increase the diversity of the workforce. I would also quickly point to the work that Dame Elise Angelini undertook on the cultural aspects the member raises, and the progress we have made in implementing the non-legislative recommendations with regards to that very important work. We are, of course, now embarked and have just passed stage one of the police ethics conduct and scrutiny.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. Supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The reality remains that the decision of the UK Labour government has made in the short time since coming to power will fundamentally damage our ability to deliver public services in Scotland. Public services need investment, as Scottish Labour frequently remind us, and you cannot cut your way to more police officers. What assessment has been made of the threat continued Westminster austerity poses to vital public services such as our police service?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in the face of financial challenges, this Government has made clear that we will provide support where it is needed the most, including through our public services such as policing. We all know that Labour austerity is as damaging as Tory austerity when it comes to public service cuts. So ahead of its autumn budget, we have again called on the UK Government to ensure that it prioritises investment in public services and infrastructure, because we know from experience that yet more Westminster austerity is not the answer that public services such as policing require and indeed must be protected.
Supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Up to 500 police officers are called to court every single day, but many of them don't end up giving evidence. And we know that criminal trials conclude much quicker when there's footage from body-worn cameras, yet most of Scotland's officers still don't have this basic kit. So does the Cabinet Secretary agree that full and speedy rollout is critical to improve policing strength in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, Presiding Officer, I do, and that's why this government, despite having our capital budget cut in real terms by nearly 9%, ensured that for this financial year, the capital budget for Police Scotland actually increased by 12.5%. I am pleased that Police Scotland have announced that the contract with Motorola is now signed. I am pleased of the update that the Chief Constable gave to the Scottish Police Authority, and it should be welcomed that by spring next year, we will see the first tranche of over 10,000 body-worn videos rolled out, with the rollout period over the forthcoming 12 months. And I'm also aware that the Chief Constable will provide updates to the Scottish Police Authority and indeed to the Scottish Government, but also to the Criminal Justice Committee.
Supplementary, Katie Clark.
From January 2022 to July this year, over 1 million 101 calls were missed, either by the caller being disconnected or by the caller simply hanging up. In June 2023, 41% of all calls went unanswered. The longest a successful caller had to hang on was 1 hour 23 minutes. What is the Cabinet Secretary doing to address this inadequate service?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important for me to say that those statistics that the member quoted have indeed been challenged by the government, and we try to do that in terms of the lines issued to the newspaper concerned, and I'm happy to follow that up in more detail with Ms Clark. It is important to recognise that in an emergency people should first and foremost call 999, which has a good record at meeting its obligations within that 10-second window frame. But in general terms, there is always more to do. There are a number of ways that people can contact Police Scotland, whether that's via email where appropriate. Obviously, 101 is not an emergency service, and it's important to underline that 999 is the emergency service.
Question number two, Pam Gosling.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports of senior lawyers seeking the introduction of a domestic abuse register.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I know myself and the Cabinet Secretary are happy to consider any innovative policy intervention that furthers our commitment to do more for victims of domestic abuse, including how that would interact with our existing initiatives. You'll be aware that the Disclosure Scheme for Domestic Abuse Scotland currently provides individuals the right to ask the police about a partner's background if they suspect a history of domestic abuse. It also enables Police Scotland to tell people that they may be at risk, even where this has not been asked for.
Pam Gosling.
I thank the Minister for that response. My proposal for a domestic abuse register has received cross-party support and the backing of many charities and organisations. Now, Thomas Ross KC has spoken movingly about the difference a register could make. He says it could prevent attacks and keep people safe. Where there are around 62,000 domestic abuse incidents, there were 62,000 domestic abuse incidents last year. That's horrific, and it needs to change. So what is the Minister waiting for? Shouldn't the Government act now and agree to introduce a register immediately?
Minister.
Thank you. And can I thank the Member? I know you are genuinely passionate about this subject. And violence against women is a fundamental violation of human rights, and the Scottish Government recognises this. The Scottish Government is aware that the Scottish Conservatives' paper, United Against Violence, includes Pam Gosling's proposal for a domestic abuse prevention bill, and met with her prior to the consultation going out. We do await more operational details, so we wouldn't be able to commit to something without seeing the full details, which I'm sure Pam Gosling will appreciate. But as I said in my first answer, we're happy to consider any proposals that makes victims of domestic abuse's lives easier.
Supplementary, Bruna Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It was welcome that the Scottish Government's programme for government affirmed the steps would be undertaken to ensure that the Equally Safe Delivery Plan continues to be implemented. Will the Cabinet Secretary speak to the funding being provided in this regard and how this plan will help to prevent and eradicate violence against women?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Frontline violence against women's services are crucial to ensuring the safety and the support to survivors. We're investing record levels of funding to support people through a range of frontline specialist services. Our Equally Safe strategy is aimed at preventing and eradicating violence against women and girls and is focused on early intervention, prevention and support. This is backed by £19 million of annual funding from our Delivering Equally Safe Fund, which has supported 121 projects from 112 organisations since October 2021.
Question number three, Mark Ruskin.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with the Scottish Prison Service to discuss the findings of the HM Inspectorate of Prison for Scotland's report on the full inspection of HMP YOI Stirling.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I welcome the inspection report from HMIPS and I'm encouraged to hear that the Chief Inspector believes that Scotland is leading the way when it comes to managing women in custody. During my visit to HMP and YOI Stirling last month, I saw firsthand the profoundly positive impact the establishment is having on women in custody. Whilst the Chief Inspector highlights many areas of good practice, SPS acknowledge that there is always room for learning and improvement. And through my regular discussions with the SPS Chief Executive, Theresa Medhurst, I am aware that the Prison Service are working to build on the positive tone of the Chief Inspector's report.
Mark Ruskin.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? We know and acknowledge that community-based trauma-informed facilities are key to breaking those cycles of pain and reoffending, and that remains, of course, at the heart of the new facility at HMP Stirling and the excellent work that goes on there. But having said that, this recent report from the Inspectorate confirmed what my constituents have been saying for over a year, which is that major design flaws at HMP Stirling have caused protracted issues with noise, which have been distressing for people both living inside and outside of the prison. So can the Cabinet Secretary update me on what lessons have been learned to ensure that future facilities do not have the same mistakes built into them? And can she assure me that SPS will provide a clear timeline on the delivery of noise mitigation measures at HMP Stirling as soon as is possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm aware that Mr Ruskell most recently met the Deputy Chief Executive of the SPS on the 11th of September, and I'm also aware that the Prison Service residents and local councillors actually met in the establishment to discuss the issue of noise. I want to reassure him and indeed other members that I continue to discuss this with the Chief Executive, because actually it's in everybody's interest that this is resolved. Obviously, when the new prison was being built, the old one had to remain in operation, and I know that the Prison Service are focused on timelines. In addition to the interpersonal interventions that they make to support women to reduce the noise, that they are also liaising with engineering professionals, acousticians, and they await a formal report from the acousticians, and they're also liaising with the local authority environmental health team as well as residents.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
This resolved.
We've got a number of supplementaries. Supplementary Jackington Barr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide detail on how the Scottish Prison Services strategy for women in custody, supported by significant investment from the Scottish Government, has changed how we support the rehabilitation of women in prison?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Prison Service strategy for women in custody represented a step change in the way Scotland views and treats women in custody by considering their very likely experience of adversity and trauma. The opening of HMP Stirling was a key milestone for the strategy to care for women, representing a third new facility built specifically for women in custody, demonstrating an unprecedented period of investment in supporting women in custody. So the innovative and groundbreaking women's facilities helped to create a culture founded on positive relationships, trust and self-worth. And by delivering a range of offending behaviour programmes, other therapeutic interventions and holistic wellbeing services, SPS have created an environment that fosters change and supports women on their rehabilitative journey.
Supplementary, Pauline McNeill, briefly, please.
At my last visit to HMP Stirling, I was made aware of some women offenders who have psychiatric conditions and the prison is not equipped to deal with them. It seems to be the key reason why local people that Mark Buskell mentions are experiencing shouting from the prison. I'm also aware that the government has responded to questions myself and others have raised about Carstairs Hospital having no female places. In view of that, is the Scottish Government assessing the various needs of women offenders serving a sentence that require special psychiatric services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to advise the member that I work very closely with health colleagues. Indeed, as a former prison social worker, I am very clear about what prison care and custody provides and what it does not. I'm also a former hospital social worker at State Hospital as well. And I can also say to the member that we are planning for high secure provision for women in the State Hospital, that the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport has met relevant health board chief executives in April to discuss that proposition. And whilst that work is at very early stages, we are absolutely committed to working with health boards to improve access for women to forensic services. And we will continue to do this as the longer-term proposition at the State Hospital is developed.
And brief supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. HMP Wyho Stirling's inspection report found positive aspects of good practice at the prison, Cabinet Secretary, but there were a number of design flaws that were indicated during that inspection, and we already know about the issues that has created for the neighbourhood and the noise. But can I once again ask what action is going to be taken to try to mitigate as much as possible the difficulties that these residents are finding with the prison service and the impact it's having on their community?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, can I say to Mr Stewart and others who have advocated on behalf of the residents that every action will be taken, and I will continue to liaise closely with the prison service on this.
Question number 4, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to tackle antisocial behaviour in Lothian.
Minister Swinburne.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We support Police Scotland and local authorities to continue to invest in prevention, early intervention and diversionary activities to reduce antisocial behaviour. They have a wide range of powers available to them and are best placed to lead on addressing these issues at a local level, ensuring that there is an appropriate response to the issues and circumstances in which the behaviour is taking place. I recognise that antisocial behaviour can be really complex, and an independent working group on antisocial behaviour is examining our strategic approach to antisocial behaviour. It's undertaking widespread engagement to deliver its report later this year, and we have committed in the programme for government to act on the group's recommendations.
Sarah Boyack.
I welcome that response and alert the Minister to the fact that we've had recent reports of antisocial behaviour having a major impact on local communities, including Lothian buses pulling services due to an increase in antisocial behaviour, and in West Lothian, an increase of 12% in antisocial behaviour, including vandalism and breach of the peace. So I welcome the fact the Minister's got a working party being put together, but does she accept that communities need support now to tackle antisocial behaviour? And in particular, our local authorities, given their under-resourcing, the impact on youth groups, community spaces, many young people in Lothian simply don't have the options, opportunities and support they need. So can the Minister tell us exactly what is going to happen to tackle the underlying issues that create antisocial behaviour in the first place?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, such behaviour is absolutely unacceptable. Everyone has a right to feel safe in their communities, and I completely condemn all such behaviour and urge anyone with information of the such incidents that have taken place recently in Lothian to contact the police. I am aware that East Lothian currently has two multi-agency groups focused on tackling antisocial behaviour. The Antisocial Behaviour Overview Group
and the weekly tasking and coordinating group. I'm also aware a collaborative approach with Police Scotland and local authorities, and I have visited one of these groups in East Lothian to see that the work they do to tackle antisocial behaviour. So there is a lot of work currently happening in this area.
And very brief supplementary, Fawzil Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I've been contacted by businesses, residents and visitors in Leith, Edinburgh regarding the escalating issues of antisocial behaviour outside New Kirkgate Shopping Centre. Assault and needles on the ground are becoming common occurrence. While the joined-up approach set out in the review of antisocial behaviour is necessary, short-term action must be taken also. Can the Minister advise how the Scottish Government is empowering police to stop antisocial behaviour as it happens?
Minister.
Thank you. While we recognise that there is no quick fix to tackling and preventing antisocial behaviour, this is why I'm strongly supportive of partnership working, having seen the projects myself that I just mentioned to Sarah Boylack, and delivering positive outcomes. I've also asked for the Scottish Community Safety Network to look at promoting best practice in partnership, working for the benefits of all local authorities, and all Police Scotland are involved in all these groups to tackle antisocial behaviour.
Question number five, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Police Scotland regarding possible criminal charges against former NHS Tayside surgeon Sam El-Jamel.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Scottish Government officials met with Police Scotland in June to discuss the establishment of the public inquiry and other developing work. As there is currently an ongoing Police Scotland investigation into the practices of Mr El-Jamel, it would not be appropriate for the Scottish Government to comment further.
Michael Mara.
Last week, Pat Kelly and Jules Rose, two victims of El-Jamel and tireless campaigners for justice for all victims, staged a protest outside the Dundee Police headquarters. Their protest marked 6 years since complaints were lodged regarding former NHS Tayside surgeon Sam El-Jamel. Campaigners have spent a decade fighting for justice. The content of the case is not a matter for the Cabinet Secretary, but the performance of our police is. Surely the Cabinet Secretary cannot believe that a 6-year delay is in any way acceptable.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I know that Mr Mara and others, and in particular Liz Smith, have diligently advocated on behalf of former patients of Mr El-Jamel. I am also aware of the representations that those campaigners and those impacted have made to Police Scotland, and I acknowledge the timeframes referenced by Mr Mara. If I could point to the public statement made by Police Scotland, when they say this is an extremely complex investigation which is being investigated by specialist officers from the major investigation team. Inquiries remain ongoing and we continue to work alongside partner agencies.
Supplementary, Liz Smith.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, a year ago at First Minister's questions, I asked the then First Minister, Hamza Youssef, if the Scottish Government would consider a victim support fund for the patients, not least because of the delays that Mr Mara has just cited. These patients, I didn't repeat to the Chamber, are undergoing terrible both physical and mental problems. Would the Government continue to support them, please?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, while the last thing, the very last thing I would do to either Ms Smith or indeed to victims is stand here and make promises that I may or may not be able to keep, but can I say to Ms Smith I would be more than happy to discuss this matter with her in further detail.
Thank you. I would advise members that I have three more questions and I have less than 8 minutes. Questions must be succinct and answers must be succinct, and we'll see what we can do. Question number six, Sue Webber.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide further details of what it's doing to ensure that Police Scotland has enough officers to deal with antisocial behaviour resulting from the illegal use of e-bikes and e-scooters.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government's budget for 24-25 includes a record police total funding of £1.55 billion, which is an increase of £92.7 million on the previous year. This funding will allow the Chief Constable to develop her plans to deliver on on her commitment to strengthen the force through the revised model of placings, including enabling the service to restart recruitment and increase office numbers. Police Scotland has welcomed over 690 new officers since March this year and over 1,280 new recruits since the beginning of 2023. Further intakes are planned throughout this year. It is important to reiterate deployment of these resources is an operational matter for Police Scotland. However, I would like to remind the Chamber that it is presently illegal to use an e-scooter on public roads, footpaths or cycle lanes in Scotland.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, Minister. The last official statistics, however, showed that Scotland has the lowest number of officers in at least 17 years. Meanwhile, recorded crime is rising, and we are repeatedly told that Police Scotland is under-resourced and overstretched. At the same time, I hear repeated reports of havoc being caused by the misuse and illegal use of e-bikes and e-scooters, and I even saw an e-skateboard the other day. People in my region have reported being frightened by mass gangs using these vehicles and detailed significant concerns for safety, with little action being taken. So other than financial support that you've outlined there, what more can the Scottish Government do to protect communities, punish those who choose to cause trouble with these illegal vehicles?
Minister.
Thank you. We share the members and public concerns regarding antisocial behaviour that can be associated with these vehicles, which may be used illegally and are a safety risk to the public, other motorists and riders themselves, as well as the police. As the member is no doubt aware, the legislation governing the registration of off-road vehicles is reserved to the UK Government. We fully support Police Scotland and its partners in dealing with illegal and irresponsible use. Local policing teams are best placed to use intelligence and engage with communities to identify where misuse of such vehicles is causing concern, and that ensures those hotspot areas can be prioritised to prevent future instances and deal with those engaged in the misuse of vehicles.
Question number 7, Edward Brighton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether the new HMP Highland will be completed by 2026 without further exceeding the reported current cost overrun of £157 million, which is a 300% increase compared to the original cost.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, following the award of the construction contract for HMP Highland in April this year, the construction is progressing to plan on site and is scheduled to be complete in 2026 within the reported budget. Early estimates of costs were made over a decade ago before a design and a site had been identified, and since then we've had years of inflation and changing economic conditions which have of course impacted on the price.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you. I'm pleased to hear it might be on time. I'm still not to believe that. What steps will be taken to ensure that prison accommodation will be available for female prisoners when the prison is completed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm very glad to hear that Mr Mountain is now advocating for the delivery of this much-needed new establishment for the Highlands. I was also made aware recently that he originally opposed the original site at Milton of Lees, which obviously wouldn't help with timescales, but nonetheless he has his democratic rights. The point he raises in terms of female prisoners is important given the geography of the Highlands, and there will be small provision to accommodate women within that.
Point of order, Edward Mountain.
I think the Minister was actually disingenuous when she responded to that. I opposed the site at Milton of Lays, which of course is not where the prison is being built. I would ask if the Minister could correct the record that I didn't oppose Highland Prison. I've been supporting it since 2006.
I thank Mr Mountain for his contribution, and I'm sure that the matter is noted on the record. I'm afraid that we'll have to draw to a conclusion. Portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs, and apologies to the member on the business bulletin that I was not able to call, and to a member that sought to ask a supplementary, but time is very tight this afternoon. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and there'll be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change position, should they so wish. Thank you.